Hi, I'm Frederick Lamar Chenemy.
Welcome to a video shoot of My Apocalypse.
If I weren't an arch enemy, what would I do? I guess I would work like every other sane person on this planet. I'd be in an office and doing a bit of marketing. But I fortunately got out of that shit and here I am. Pretending I'm working, just having fun, of course.
If I wasn't an arch enemy right now, I'd probably be working with music in some other field, perhaps in sound engineering.
If I weren't an arch enemy now, I would probably be still working with my own band, which have no name, but which I recorded about 11 songs with, and struggling around finding the right singer, so I'm probably still gonna do that, and doing some session jobs with some other bands. And
well, I mean, if I were an arch enemy, I mean, I would probably have a real job and actually make money, be able to afford stuff, but now I'm just like a poor little struggling musician fighting for, you know, my art and everything. It's a hard life, somebody's got to do it, you know. I cry myself to sleep every night, but that's where I draw my inspiration.
Last year we spent about half a year on tour, and it's like you want to get a contrast on the touring life as soon as you can, and every time, every chance you get to relax or do something else is a blessing.
We work still when we're home because we do other stuff. We write new music, you know, we work on DVDs, artwork, you know, I sing a lot. But obviously I can do that at night if I want to, so I have a very free day and I really enjoy that. And I do all the other stuff, like, you know, I do some sports, I love cooking, you know, I do the household. I meet up with my friends, which I don't see much when I'm away. I visit my family. And otherwise, I just, you know, take it easy a bit because touring is kind of tough. And I need a bit of, especially right after the tour, I basically need 2 weeks off to recover a bit.
Working on riffs and playing guitar as usual.
Being away from home, it's quite good since I live in a little rat hole. So, you know, to be in a plush tour bus, it's actually, you know, it's quite good for me. It's good for a change. It doesn't smell as much as my home does. So, you know, I'm quite happy doing that.
Being away from home, you know, usually, you know, 6 months, a year, half the year away and away from family and stuff like that can be tough. But at the same time, it's something that I kind of grown accustomed to now. It's how I live my life, and for so many years now that I've just become, I kind of get restless when I'm at home for too long. So I'm sitting around at home for a couple of months, I'm really itching to go get back out and change of scenery. So I've got a pretty good balance in my life, I think. It's okay.
Playing Australia was great, actually, because it's, you know, something that's completely new. We haven't been there before, and we got like such a warm welcome. People, it was like, you know, we came in, it was like loads of people at all the shows, and because you never know, when you haven't been a place before, have no idea what it's going to be like, and it was just like, you know, beyond my, you know, wildest imagination. Didn't see one single kangaroo, one single koala, but I mean, there you go, be more times for that.
Touring Australia last year was amazing. I mean, we had such a good time, really, really cool,
and the crowd was amazing. Really crazy, a crazy bunch.
It's one of the most amazing trips I've done in my life.
It's a shame we didn't do it earlier, but we didn't have the possibilities to go. It's a very beautiful country, it's huge. We only did 3 dates in Brisbane, Melbourne and Sydney, and that wasn't enough, obviously, because it's hard to cover that big place, continent, basically. And yeah, I would like to live there, but it's just so far away from Europe that, yeah, if the traveling bit wasn't, you know, I think I maybe would move this. So, and it's kind of, they kind of keep out of the world politics a bit. I like that kind of attitude, you know. They don't mix in to other people's policies all the time. They try to take care of their own problems, and I kind of like that attitude.
In Japan, we have a very different, you know, the audience there is quite different from the rest of the world. They're a bit more, they very pay a lot of attention to what the band is doing as far as, you know, speaking between songs. It's very quiet and they really listen. So it kind of dies down. It's very, you could hear a pin drop on stage because it's just so quiet. And there's 2,000 kids in the audience, but it's like dead silent. They're just hanging on to every word. And then, you know, but they totally get into it when you play. The crowd is very enthusiastic there, but it's totally different from anywhere else in the world. And sometimes I think, sometimes it can freak you out, because you're just like, why is there anybody out there? Is it just the venue empty? You know, when, and then you go out and look, you peek through that curtain, it's like, it's packed. It's just that they don't make a lot of noise before the show. But when you, once you start playing, they go crazy, and that's the important thing, you know. We've been so lucky that we've played so many times in Japan, toured a lot over there, and I think last time I was over there was my 20th visit or something like that, so I've been definitely blessed in that sense. And yeah, it's one of my favorite places to go to. It's just got a lot of friends there, and it's a great atmosphere, and I like the culture and everything about it, really.
I wish I had I could pinpoint like a single drummer that's my favorite. But fact is, I listen to that a lot of different types of music and a lot of different types of drummers, and I've got a couple that I like a lot. Like drummers like Neil Peart, been really important in my, as an influence to me, and like Dave Lombardo. And when I first started drumming, it was my older brother, because he started drumming before me, and obviously he had a kit in the house, and I was just a kid and saw him play, so.
Among my favorites are guys like Michael Schenker, John Ulroth, Frank Marino.
I learned from just watching him play. As I said, I was only a kid, like 7 years old, and he was in his early teens, so I saw him practice, and I got really inspired by that.
My favorite guitar player of all time, I mean, there's so many great guitar players, and if I had to pick one, probably Michael Schenker from UFO and MSG. I think he's just he's been a big influence on my playing. But there are many other greats, like, you know, Tony Iommi and Richie Blackmore, Frank Marino. There's a lot of great. The players I like are usually hail from the sort of 70s era rock, hard rock scene. I think a lot of new ground was broken there as far as guitar playing goes. Then also you had the 80s with people like Ingvar Malmsteen and that whole thing. That was very impressive. And then also a big influence on me has been the thrash, growing up with the thrash metal stuff, you know. So I mean, James Hetfield and Dave Mustaine and the guys from Slayer have been a big influence of me as well, as far as my rhythm playing goes, and so it's all it's just a big mess, really, my influences.
Favorite singer of all time? That's always a tough question, because there's so many good ones out there. But I think it's maybe Rob Halford from Judas Priest. I like, he's a heavy metal singer, I mean, he's like a classic metal singer, but he has a lot of edge in his voice, and he can actually growl. I've heard I saw him in 2004 in Stockholm, and he has like a very varied voice and very, very metal. And I think that's my favorite singer of all time. I don't think he has influenced me that much though, because I'm obviously coming from a different background. It's more like death metal and thrash metal. When I started out, it was like 1990. It was the big wave of death metal coming from America and England, and bands like Morbid Angel, Carcass, Entombed, Dismember, you know, this kind of stuff, Obituary, that kind of stuff influenced me vocally. Yeah, obviously. But if I could pull that off, what Rob Halford does, I would do it. But I think it's really tough what he does with his voice. Not many people can. There's no second Rob Halford out there.
I do get nervous before shows in a sudden. Just not really, not the whole day or anything like that. It's just right when the intro tape is playing and the lights are down, and it's like, this is it. You can intro music just like basically a couple of minutes before you're going to hit the stage. I always get a little bit of a, you know, feeling in my stomach, you know, like butterflies, whatever you might call it. But it's a good, it gives you that extra edge, I think, you know, just go out there and do your best.
And the only preparation is basically a certain warm-up routines, which, I mean, the most important one is basically, it's something like, it's the thing for the wrist, because I had problems with my wrist. So what I do now is I grab a bottle of Jim Beam, and I sort of like, you know, twist the top off, and then you do that. And then for the other hand, it's like you do that. And it's quite good, actually, because now I loosen up and I'm ready for the show. Oh, see? Groupies already.
How I warm up or how I prepare for a show is, it's always the same, really. It's kind of, I just try to sleep as long as possible during the day and then get up, and I like, you know, I'd least like to play guitar for an hour before the show. So that's the most important part, is to be fully warmed up and have that, you know, feeling that you're in control of your instrument.
Well, before the show, I'd like to, you know, just warm up and get my pulse pumping a bit. I get the adrenaline going a bit, and I'd say if I didn't get nervous, something would be wrong. So it's a good thing. It's a good thing to get nervous.
How do I take care of my voice? Well, I do all kinds of things. I don't know where to start. Obviously, I obviously had vocal coaching in the beginning when I joined Arch Enemy, because I had a problem with my vocal cords called nodules. It's like soft bumps on the vocal cords that happen when you scream the wrong way and you kind of overuse them. And I had to get rid of these nodules, and I had proper vocal coaching where I basically learned to breathe right. I didn't have any breathing technique. I was just like, you know, chest full of air, and then I started screaming, and that puts a hell lot of pressure on your larynx and your vocal cords, way too much. And if you do the right abdominal breathing and the rib cage breathing, that doesn't happen. So I think that was the most important lesson I learned. And others are, you know, I've learned a really good vocal warm-up, which tells me how my voice is that day. A lot of people don't know that. Just go on stage and it's not really coming out what I want to come out. So I'm always prepared before I go on stage. And now my voice is great today. I can just do whatever crazy stuff I want to do. And my voice is like so and so, and I better leave the really long high screams out or whatever is that shreds your throat. I mean, everybody has a weak spot where he knows, well, if I do that, that really scratches. So, and, you know, I have vocal hygiene. It's, for example, don't drink and smoke, at least on tour, which is tough because everybody's partying, and it takes a lot of discipline, I think. It's very tempting. I party a bit in the end, you know, just not to feel totally left out. And then it doesn't matter because, like, the last four or five shows I can pull off anyway. And I have days where I don't talk. If I get sick, like have a cold and a bronchitis, it's usually I've got all of it at the same time, I go to the doctor, get antibiotics straight away, and I stop talking. Because talking actually is a permanent grind on the vocal cords. People don't know that. It's actually sometimes tougher on the vocal cords than just singing or screaming. So, but you need a lot of discipline for that, because that's really depressing, not being able to talk for a day. And if it's a day off, I try to pull that off for 24 hours to the next show. But I mean, it drives me crazy sometimes. I'm really good in sign language. I'm like, food, sleep, shower.
When you're rehearsing, you're just thinking about, oh my God, it'd be great to just be out on the road now. And then when you're on the road, you think, wow, it'd be great just to be hanging out and jamming in the studio. And when you're in the studio for too long, it's kind of like, I'd like to do something else. But I guess, you know, I enjoy all of them, really. Can't complain. I've had worse jobs, worse gigs.
I've learned a lot from all the different bands that I've been in, but it's great to be able to get in. I mean, I wasn't an Arch Enemy from the beginning, Epidemic came in like before the sort of like the big breakthrough, and it's been great to be able to sort of like help build something instead of what I've done before and just like jump into something that was already established, which was great. I learned a lot from it, but to be able to be there and do something for it, I mean, it's a little more sort of like a little more gratification in that.
Changing guitar players was very emotional for me because, you know, obviously Chris is my brother and we've been playing together. We started this band together and we've been playing together for so long. We knew each other so well musically and obviously personally as well, growing up together. I hated to see that. I was really emotional about it, that he wanted to quit the band, and I didn't really see how we could move on with somebody else at that time. I was kind of caught up in this. I was holding on to that the feeling of that it should be the two of us. But obviously, you know, I calmed down and, you know, we started playing with some other people. We had a guy called Gus G come out with us on the Ozfest, which was great because, I mean, he really helped us out. And actually, that I just felt that this kind of works anyway. It still sounds like Arch Enemy, so, and that was a pretty good atmosphere on that tour. And then now we've got Frederick in the band, and he fits in really, really well. And actually, I found that it's had a lot of positive effect on myself as a player because I kind of feel a little bit more challenged now. That with my brother, I think I was becoming, or we were both as a guitar team, maybe becoming a bit complacent, a bit too relaxed, you know. There was nothing that we could do really to impress each other. It was kind of, we've seen it all. And I don't think we were pushing it maybe the last year or so as much as we had done in the past. But who knows, I mean, that might have come back, that spark. But I think right now, I'm enjoying playing with Frederick a lot and we're just playing a lot of guitar and, you know, always jamming and writing a lot of new music. And yeah, I think I've improved a lot thanks to bringing in a new, playing with some different players has made me raise the bar, hopefully.
Me on stage and me off stage, there's obviously no difference at all. I'm just crazy ass. No, I'm not. Well, Angela on stage is aggressive and, you know, very extroverted, you know, getting people up and going, and, you know, playing a show. And at home, I'm not playing a show. I'm just being me, and I'm very calm at home because, you know, I do have all the excitement on stage and in the band, and I don't need to profile myself at home. You know, I'm rather the one stepping back and staying in the background, and except when I drink alcohol, then my stage persona comes back out again. Which is pretty extreme, I guess. But yeah, I'm a really calm person off stage, I think.
I think over the last 5 years, Arch Enemy has developed a lot, and it's been really interesting. I think we've moved really. We've really looked deep into ourselves for the songwriting, and I think early on it was kind of really thrown together. And we got some great results early on, I think. But I think we've developed a lot of songwriters. But hopefully we can retain the aggression and the primal sort of, you know, atmosphere that I think every metal band should have. And I hate to see, I mean, I'm a fan of bands myself. And, you know, I hate to see bands wimp out and sell out or whatever, you know, where it's like, oh, I really love their first couple of records, but then they kind of got a bit softer. I think Arch Enemy's retained that hard edge, and we haven't compromised with the vocals or the, you know, the heavy guitars or anything. So I don't think you could really say that we've softened our sound. I think it's some ways. I mean, Anthems of Rebellion, I think, was one of the hardest records we've ever made because it was just so relentless. Yeah, I think over the last 5 years we've yeah, we've obviously become a lot better live. We've toured so much. We've been all across the world so many times. So So it's been, since Angela joined, really, and we really focused on Arch Enemy, and just because everybody was kind of doing a lot of different projects, and when Angela joined, we said, okay, this is it. We've got to focus 100% on this one band and just be very, you know, gung-ho about it and just go out and do as much touring as we can and become a serious live band. And I think we've accomplished that many times over.
If you're watching this DVD, I sincerely hope you bought it. Because if you didn't, I mean, look at me. Look at me, I gotta live. God damn it.
Yeah, I mean, with the fans, it's really a case of, you know, it's just the best feeling in the world to go out there and be able to play live, and there's people coming to the show and people buying the records, which, you know, makes us able to make new records and keep doing this. And it's just kind of it's a give and take situation, I think. You know, they give you a lot of energy, and we give them hopefully energy to, you know, I mean, growing up, I was such a huge fan of metal, and listening to records really gave me the strength to, you know, live my life and as a young teenager. And hopefully, you know, I see that we can give that back to kids, you know, to metal fans. Just good music and, you know, come to the shows and have a good time, and it's just a great energy.
Yeah, thanks for the ride. I'm with Arch Enemy now since almost 6 years, I believe, or 5 years at least. And I've had a great time. And I only had that great time because we have fans. You know, without fans, there is no band, there is no show, there is no record, there is no record sales. Nobody gives a shit. And yeah, we are here because of our fans, and they're getting, every day we hopefully gain a few more, and thanks to everybody who's watching that. You obviously bought the DVD. And hope to see you on the road in 2006.